Hi, everyone, and welcome to our English for the Workplace live broadcast, stream, whatever. I'm joined by Jenny and David, educators on the English for the Workplace course. Hello to both of you.
Hello to you. Hello to everyone watching.
We're here to answer all of your questions about English for work, whether you're looking for a job, applying for a job, going to an interview, starting work in a new job, or you just want to improve your English for your everyday work in the job that you have. We'll talk about everything we can. We'll answer as many of your questions as possible. And hopefully we'll share some really useful tips and advice with you. So while we're talking for the next minute or two, just tell us in the comments where you're watching from, say hi, and then we'll get on to talking about questions and everything. But I'm going to go to Jenny first to talk a little bit about the course. Jenny.
Okay, thanks, Neil. So this is a four-week course, English for the Workplace. And this course really covers anything you would ever need to know about working and workplace English in particular. So it takes you through the process of applying for a job. So you think about, you know, what you're looking for in a job, your own skills, where you can find job advertisements, then how to apply for a job, how to write your CV and cover letter. We then go on to looking at job interviews and how to do really well, how to feel well prepared for a job interview. And weeks 3 and 4 of the course focus more on what to do when you're actually, when you've got your job and you're in the workplace, looking at, you know, questions you need to ask when you're settling into a new job, dealing with disagreements with colleagues, team building, health and safety, and all of these kind of daily workplace challenges and issues. Mm-hmm.
Okay, sounds great. And I know there's lots of really useful stuff in the course and lots of videos and discussions and chances to ask and answer questions and stuff. David, can you say a little bit more maybe about who the course would be good for and how it maybe works on a like everyday basis?
Well, the course is for anyone who's looking for work, particularly, I guess, if you're looking to work in English, but I would say a lot of the ideas would help you even if you're looking for work in a non-English speaking environment. It's also very useful for anyone who's starting a job, particularly from week 3, which is next week of the course. You're looking more at you've started work and how to get on with colleagues and the practical advice along those lines. And in terms of how it works, so you have to sign up for the course. It is free, so that's a very good price for everyone. I think we can all afford that. And basically, you sign in. Once you signed in and joined, it's up to you really how you go about it. As Jenny mentioned, it's a four-week course, but if there's bits that are maybe not that useful for you, maybe you've already got a job, so you don't need to know about how to do an interview, and you just want to go straight to the bits about how to start work and how to get on with colleagues, that's fine. You can pick and choose what is useful for you. You can do 5 minutes a day. You could do an hour a day. It's totally up to you how you go about the course. And I think that's actually one of the good things about it is that it's very flexible, how you can just dip in and out as you have time available.
Okay, great. As you've seen while you've been talking, I've just flashed up some of the many countries that we've got watching us. And, you know, we're covering all over the world there. We have people watching from South Asia, the Middle East, Southeast Asia, South America, Central America, Africa, all over. So that's great. So lots of people watching us. So someone just rang my doorbell. David told us before we began that he was expecting a delivery. Perhaps they've sent it to the wrong address. I don't know.
The wrong country, yeah.
Okay. Before we begin, like I was going to say, I want to just get to know a little bit about you, the people who are watching us just now. So we'd like to just ask you to tell us a little bit about yourselves. So the first question that I'd like to ask everyone who's watching is just finish this sentence for you. Tell us about the kind of job that you would like. I'd like to have a job that or which or where I or, you know, etc. Just finish the sentence and tell us about you. Let's begin with David and Jenny. Okay, We've all got jobs at the moment, but if you could change your job, or if you were going to change your job, Jenny, how would you finish this sentence for you? What would be most important for you, you think?
Okay, I think for me, it would be I'd like to have a job that is flexible enough to fit around my family.
Mm-hmm. Excellent answer there. Okay, very good. I mean, that, you know, I mean, obviously the grammar and everything was excellent, but I mean the content was very good. So, listening, exactly, flexible enough to fit around your family, very important, and not always easy to find. So that's a good mm-hmm. one there. David, how would you finish that sentence?
I'd like to have a job where I was sent to watch the World Cup and be paid to do it.
Okay. Not too many jobs of that kind. I guess that would be sports journalist or sports correspondent.
Yeah, I think so. I think I could accept that if there's any offers in the next 24 hours before the World Cup starts.
Okay. My cousin has actually got that job, David. I'll put a good word in for you.
Okay.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Lots of great answers coming in already. This is fantastic. So from Idam Manukan, I'd like to have a job that provides me with flexibility, freedom, and security. Okay. Anna Simon is saying, I would like to have a job that serves the community. Arisha's a little bit similar to Jenny's answer, but I'd like to have an interesting and flexible job with a good salary. Yep, all important things. And Maher's just agreeing with that. I'd like to have a job that pays handsomely. I'm 100% with you there, Maher. Me too. Let's see some of the others because there are a lot of good ones here. Jose Luis says, I'd like to have a job which let me use all my potential and put into practice my English. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Martha's Crafts, I think the clue is perhaps in the username there, is I'd like to have a job where I could enjoy nature with my students. That does sound lovely. Mm-hmm. Okay, great. So that's the kind of thing that we're looking for there. Let's just have another couple of these. Actually, yeah, let's go, you know, let's be negative.
It wouldn't be you, Neil, if there was no negativity.
Exactly. I mean, all this positivity is too much. It's too hard work for me. Let's go back to something simpler. Mm-hmm. I'd prefer not to. Okay, so we've talked about that we would like jobs that are flexible or that have a good salary or that can help the community. Lots of great suggestions there. How about mm-hmm. I'd prefer not to? David, if this was one for you, what would you say?
I'd prefer not to work long hours for mm-hmm. a low salary.
Okay. I cannot argue with that. Yes. Uh-huh. Jenny?
I'd prefer not to have to deal with lots of paperwork.
I can sympathize with that as well. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I'd a bit like you, I'd prefer not to have to work a lot with spreadsheets and figures and so mm-hmm. on. You know, it's my least favorite part of work is that. Okay, let's see if we've got answers from our viewers. Not yet for the I'd prefer not to. See, everyone watching is too positive. Okay. And Maher has just confirmed that there. I prefer not to be negative at work. That's an excellent mindset, Maher. Absolutely. One that I'm famous for, as David will tell you. Jose Luis, I'd prefer not to work under pressure. Another good one there. A bit like David's one here, I'd prefer not to spend more than 8 hours working. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Very good. Arisha, I'd prefer not to work during summer season. Kika, I'm on Kika's side with this one. I'd prefer not to work at all.
But still be paid, I presume.
Yes, I can see that. Some personal experiences perhaps creeping in here now with mm-hmm. I'd prefer not to work with selfish co-workers. This one I can also you know, I can see something in this. I prefer not to have a boss from Ida. Okay, excellent. So I think we know a little bit more about you now and some great questions there. We're going to move on now to talk about some of the specific questions and skills that we look at on the course and some questions people have been asking us, practical questions about applying for work and so on. So let's begin with the first one here from Ina Maximovic or Maximovic, who says, I'd like to ask our educators about their first experience of having a job interview. Was it successful and how did you feel? Let's begin with Jenny here. Can you remember? I'm not suggesting it was a long time ago, but.
I think it was. I think I was lucky enough to go for a long, long time without a very formal job interview. Mm-hmm. So I had lots of, you know, starting from when I was a teenager, part-time jobs, I had lots of very informal chats where they basically just kind of checked that I was, you know, basically okay and could work. And I don't think I had my first kind of formal sit-down panel interview until I was much, much older, and it was probably my first teaching job. And I do remember feeling nervous, but also very excited, just looking forward to the whole experience. And I think it's good if you can strike that balance with feeling nervous, but not in a way that's going to, you know, shut you down completely. You feel like a little bit excited at the possibility of answering the questions and hopefully doing well. So, yeah.
And do you remember, were you really keen to get that job? I mean, was it one that you really wanted, that first
one? Yes. Yes, it was. It was a job. It was a job that I wanted. It was a job, a teaching job, actually, mm-hmm. at a college, and I was really keen to get it.
I hope you were successful.
I was successful.
Okay, good. Okay, positive start there. Now over to David.
Mm-hmm. My first experience was pretty bad, to be honest. I think I did everything wrong. The one thing, actually, I got two things right. I dressed correctly and I turned up on time. And after that, it all went wrong. But
that sounds exactly like mine. So that's.
And I think basically I didn't really know very much about the job. As a result, I didn't really know what they might ask me. And I think it was quite clear within 5 minutes that the quicker this was finished for both of us, the person interviewing me and myself, the better, because there was no way I was going to get that job. Mm-hmm. In my defense, it was pre-internet, so it was a bit harder to find out things about company and what exactly they were about and the kind of research you can do today. But it wasn't a good experience, but it has got better. I do have a job now.
Yeah, mine was exactly the same as you. And as you say, it was very different in the days before the internet. Mm-hmm. You didn't have the chance to do courses like this. You didn't have a chance to Google all the advice on how to do interviews or anything like that. And, you know, we weren't taught at school how to do these things either. So, yeah. The first time was a disaster for me, like you. I turned up on time. I wore a nice shirt and tie and jacket, but didn't have a clue how to answer any of the questions that were asked, and it wasn't successful. But I never really improved, to be honest, and I'm just very lucky to have a job. Okay, so tell us, the people who are watching, tell us in the comments about your experience. We've got one here from Kika. I was nervous, but they only asked me about some information about myself. It was funny, and guess what? I succeeded. So, yeah, that's a dream job interview where there are no difficult questions, just some nice, easy ones that you can answer fine, and then they offer you the job. That's great. Okay, let's see if there's any more people. I mean, Sat mentions was successful, but okay, right. Let's move on to our next question. Now, this is a question we get asked all the time. Perhaps the most common interview question in the world is something like, tell me about yourself, or some variation on that. What's the best way to approach an prepare and answer that question. David, let's begin with you.
Well, I think the first step is actually what you just said there, Neil, which is to prepare, because it is a predictable question. It may be worded in slightly different ways depending on the interviewer, but basically it will be the same question either way. What you really need to focus on here is telling people, probably in a relatively short frame of time, relevant things about your job experience and maybe your qualifications, especially if you have very limited job experience, that would make you the person they would want to hire. So, you know, if you're going for a job in finance, you might want to talk about previous work you have done, you know, with working in a financial department or for a bank or anything relevant to do with that. If this is your first job, you might want to reference things where you've had that type of responsibility. Obviously, in certain cases, you may not yet have done exactly the things that are in the job or it's going to be expected in the job. If they've asked you for an interview, they know that, but they want to know maybe more about how you have done things which are similar, if not exactly the same. So, but in general, you want to keep it focused on professional things. Mm-hmm. And maybe I would say relatively short. I mean, they can always ask you for more information if they think they want more from you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so focus on professional things, achievements and things like that, and experience. Don't talk about your cat, basically, or something like that, yes.
Yeah, unless you're going for a job at the vets or something.
Or a pet shop, yes. Okay, Jenny, what would you add to David's answer there?
Yeah, maybe I would say, like, if you don't have very much work experience, it might be okay to include maybe just a couple of personal qualities that are relevant for the job. So, for example, if it's a very person-orientated job and you're a very friendly person who loves listening to people, I think it would be okay to include that too. And also, I think, yeah, keep the tone, think about the tone, and this is where preparation is really good. You can practice saying it maybe and just have it sounding as upbeat and enthusiastic as you can. Remember to smile when you're speaking, because this will make it sound better. And just also, though, a word of caution is don't make it sound over rehearsed. Don't be tempted to memorize what you've written, because the interviewer will be able to tell. So there's a fine balance between preparing it and over-preparing it.
I think those are both really good points to think about, and I think it's worth just repeating them for people. You know, we haven't really talked about that, but, you know, exactly the tone you mentioned about keeping it upbeat and being positive and friendly. I mean, that's going to, you know, the impression that you give, that will really help, rather than, you know, looking down at the ground or something, or you know, as you say, sounding like you've practiced and you're reading from a list. So to talk as if you're talking to people and get the tone right. And as you said, don't learn a script and deliver it exactly.
And also that I think you have to make it relevant to the one you're being interviewed for. That one of the other dangers of learning a script is you just say the same thing every time. And you might be talking about things that are not really relevant to the job you're being interviewed for. So you have to refresh it for each country, each interview or each company that you're talking to.
Okay. Arisha's got a memory of the first job experience in kindergarten. I worked in kindergarten for 6 months. After that, I ran away and never went back. The kids were very naughty and I was afraid of them. Yep, I can imagine that. Okay. Let's move on to our next question. So we've spoken about how you start your interview and the beginning part. Natalia Loizaga is asked the other end of the interview. At the end of the interview, almost every interview will finish with the interviewers, the panel or the person saying, "Do you have any questions you'd like to ask us?" or something like that. And Natalia is asking, can we give examples of what kind of questions could we ask then? Jenny, what do you think?
I think it's good to ask a question which shows you're genuinely interested in the company, rather than you're just asking a question because they've asked you if you want to ask a question. Mm-hmm. And a question that I think is quite a nice one to ask is to ask the interviewer, what do you like best about working at this company? And that will give you a kind of insight into, an employee's view of the company. And it also just reverses the positions for a minute. So you have to, you can watch them think carefully about how to answer. So I think that's a possible question. Also a question which I think can be quite good because it shows that you're thinking about your future at the company is maybe asking about possibilities for training and professional development. That shows you're committed and you're wanting to, keep learning on the job.
Okay, so turn the tables would be the phrase there. Turn the tables on the interviewer and ask them a similar question to some of the ones they asked you before about how they feel and so on about the company, and maybe things about how they see the future of the company, things like that. Okay, great. Okay, David.
I don't have a specific question, maybe as an example, but I think one thing that's important here is to bear in mind this is your way of evaluating the company and the people you'll be going to be working with. So the types of questions that Jenny has mentioned would help you do that. That I think there's a tendency we always think an interview is exclusively about the company judging if they want you, but you should always bear in mind, do you want to work for them and how they conduct themselves during the interview or how they respond to questions like this is a very important part. So whatever is of interest for you is it's good to have a question ready to so you can help you make that kind of decision, because hopefully you're not just going to say yes to the first company that offers you a job. I mean, obviously your financial situation may force you to do that, but if they really come across negatively, this is one of the ways you can find that out before saying yes and working for them.
Okay, excellent advice there as well. Maher's got a suggestion here as well, some suggestions saying you could ask about their values, the company's values, how they uphold them, and maybe questions about pay, remuneration, or promotion. You mentioned about prospects and training and things like that. Okay, excellent. Okay, let's move on to our next question. Remember, everyone who's watching, if you have any questions that you want to ask us about English for work, applying for a job, working in a company, using English as part of your job, improving your skills, anything like that, just ask us the question in the comments and we'll answer. This next question, okay, I really like this question, but it's a bit long, so be patient as I talk through it. Regis Fruming is saying, okay, if I got a job, imagine if I got a job and in the first few days I saw many things wrong. Okay, so you've started the job. It could be processes, ways that they could do things better, ways that they weren't perhaps efficient, or it could be co-workers' behaviors, the way that people are speaking to each other or acting with each other. What should I do? Okay, now I think these are two quite different things, maybe from my point of view, as to what you would do about them or whether you would do something about them at the beginning of a job. But what would you say, Jenny? Let's start with you.
I think at the very beginning of the job, it would be wise not to take immediate action unless these co-workers were really blocking you in what you were trying to do or being, extremely unpleasant. If you were just observing less than ideal behavior, I would not necessarily say anything immediately. What I would do is just observe. I would take notes. I would jot down anything I saw that wasn't quite, right. And then I would take time to observe the company. Possibly there would be regular review meetings. There'd be possibly different working groups. So when we're thinking about processes that could be better, you might be able to join a working group that would appreciate some of your input. It would also be good to observe the structure of power, who reports to who, because if you have complaints or observations about co-workers' behavior, is there somebody that you could talk to about this at a later date, and who is the appropriate person to speak to? Most organizations will have some kind of process, so you want to make sure you're following the right process in that case. But you also want to make sure that what you've observed is correct. You know, maybe you've just arrived and you've just seen somebody having a bad day and they don't normally behave mm-hmm. like that. So I'd suggest in the co-worker's case, giving it a little bit of time, seeing if this definitely is the case, and then thinking carefully about what to do about it and what the correct mm-hmm. Channel would be.
Okay, very good advice there. I just saw a question from Sokor Chorn saying, can I drop a question in the comment here? Absolutely. If you're watching mm-hmm. and you want to ask a question, either from your own idea now or because of something we say or some comment we make, just ask us in the comments. Okay, so Jenny's advice there, I think very good, especially about the processes. I was thinking the same thing as you. When you've just started, maybe you're used to doing things a different way in another mm-hmm. company, but maybe there's a very good reason they do it this way mm-hmm. and just wait and see what's happening. David, anything you'd add to that? I mean, I was also thinking about the coworkers' behaviors. Mm-hmm. Generally, I would agree with Jenny, mm-hmm. wait a little and see, but I guess there could be situations where maybe you could think about maybe, this is something quite important. What would you
think? Well, I think there's several factors here, including is it just behavior you personally don't like, or mm-hmm. is it something that is clearly wrong, like, I don't know, theft, for example, which would be clearly wrong, in which case mm-hmm. you probably do need to report it to someone if it's clear and obvious.
Or maybe things like, I guess could be racism or something, or sexism or something like that, or some things that were, mm-hmm. Causing you personal harm and offense. Mm-hmm.
In which case, as I think Jenny said, there should be either you have a particular person to report it to, like your line mm-hmm. manager, or there could be a system within the company where you can do that. I think it's also worth bearing in mind, if we take this quite literally as the first few days, is it just that the culture maybe is a bit different? I mean, mm-hmm. if you're moving to not just a different company, but maybe from the UK, like we are from, and you go to work in another country, maybe they just do things differently and certain ways of behavior sound bad, but they're actually mm-hmm. not. It's just people talk in a slightly, British people tend to be a little bit polite, especially with strangers. I mean, Neil accepted, but... maybe in another country, people are just much more direct, and you might find that offensive as a British person. But actually, it's just normal, and there's nothing mm-hmm. intended by it. So maybe you also have to think of, I think it's a difficult one.
Yeah.
To jump. I think jumping to the conclusions is maybe something you should try to avoid is the key thing here.
so give it time, watch and observe, mm-hmm. as Jenny says, take notes, and then, when you're sure of yourself, then maybe do something. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's very good advice. As you say,
asking questions is everything. I was just thinking, you don't have to accuse anybody or anything. You could mm-hmm. just say, is it okay to, and then give the example that you may mm-hmm. have seen, And then people say, that's
a good suggestion. Correct. Okay, so maybe ask your line manager, is it okay to, is it normal to? Okay, asking questions, always good advice. Mm-hmm. Okay, and as you mentioned, of course, more and more people are working in different, not just moving, like you were mentioned, from one country to another, but you're working in multinational teams mm-hmm. in the same job, in the same company, and you might go from one culture where people behave in a certain way in an office mm-hmm. to where people behave completely differently, and mm-hmm. It's something to get used to rather than, complain about, perhaps. Okay, my favorite question of the day, I just have to put up on the screen, from Tan Tan Nui. Is this really live? I see the talks in the words on the screen. Well, I think we've just proved to you that it's live. But yes, there are subtitles. It's the wonders of modern technology. Mm-hmm. Even with our Scottish accents, they can put the subtitles up very quickly live on that, and it's working. So yes, we are here. Okay, let me just have a quick look, because I noticed some other live questions there. Sorry about this pause. This is going back earlier, but a question about interviews, okay? Mm-hmm. And something Jenny kind of mentioned earlier about the tone and upbeat and things like that. But another part of that, what about eye content? On eye content? Generally, my eyes just contain eyes, but okay.
Yes.
Jenny, what about eye contact while speaking?
Generally, generally, I think eye contact is very important. That doesn't mean fixing the person you're talking to in a stare. You just looking at them when you're making points. And something that people sometimes ask about is if it's a panel interview. So if there's more than one person interviewing you, how do you work with eye contact then? And I would suggest making eye contact mostly with the person who's asked you the question, but including the people on the panel as well while you're talking to them by looking at them occasionally. But yeah, I mean, eye contact is really important. It shows you're confident. People are more likely to trust you as well if you make eye contact with them.
And as you say, it shows confidence, and they're more likely to trust you. It's really important. But sometimes when you're nervous, it's not always easy, David. Is there anything you can do about that to kind of practice or prepare or improve if it's something that maybe that you're not good at, or you get nervous and sometimes you don't look people in the eye as much as you should.
I think you just need I think you need to be aware of what you're doing so that if you realize, I mean, it's not a huge problem if occasionally you look at the floor or whatever, or up at the sky, because that's what a lot of people do when they're thinking and they're searching for information and memories or whatever. So the fact that you're not constantly staring at someone is not a problem, but if you get so fixed on that that you're never looking at people, you need to find a way of making yourself aware of that. Maybe videoing yourself when you're practicing, so you can go, ah, actually, I was looking everywhere but at the person that I was speaking to. It's practice, like a lot of things, that you just force yourself to do it. I mean, you may also have the opposite experience, I think it's worth mentioning, that the people talking to you are not making eye contact with you, which, for example, because they're taking notes about your answers or whatever. Maybe they're just strange people who never make eye contact either. But and I think just to set that, it's not a problem. You
Not
can't
impossible.
control what other people do. I don't think it would be a comment either on what you are personally doing.
Okay. Another excellent question here from Didier. Are there differences between an interview in a big company and in a small one? I mean, I would say that there are probably differences between interviews in every company, but are there any kind of general things that we could say that might be different between a small company and big company? Is it important? Is it something to think about, Jenny?
Something I can think of is that in a very big company, it might be, they might have a human resource person interviewing you. So it's maybe not somebody who does a similar, even a similar job that you're doing. It's somebody who works for the company who is their job is to hire people. So I think that makes it a slightly different dynamic than if you're being interviewed by somebody who's going to be working alongside you. So for example, when we were talking about the questions that you would ask at the end of the interview, if it would be a slightly different answer if you asked a human resources person because they're going to be doing something quite different from you unless you're applying for a job in human resources as well. I think that's, I mean, ultimately the sort of format of the interview will be the same and the kind of questions you'll be asked will be similar, though I don't think there's any going to be any big differences.
David, any thoughts on this?
I think there is a chance in a small company, especially a very small one, that it's more of a one-to-one interview rather than, whereas in a big company, it's almost certainly going to be a panel, at least two people, probably three, who are interviewing you. That could make you more nervous because there's more people who are listening to you. And I think another difference, but it might not be that obvious when you're doing it, is in a big company, there might be a more fixed structure to the interview with fixed questions, because the company may have, a policy about how to make interviews fair. Possibly in a small company, especially if it's, like I said, it's like more of a one-to-one, it could be a bit more of a chat, and it might be, as a result, the types of questions or how they're presented to you might be a little bit different, but I think if you were preparing, you're kind of preparing the same way. Think of it that way.
When it comes to the actual interview portion, it's probably going to be very similar questions and things like that. But yeah, in big companies, they also tend to often have not just a very structured interview, but sometimes they have a very structured whole recruitment process.
Yes.
And there's sometimes testing and exams, you know, things to do first and different stages that you go through and things like that that a smaller company might not do. Mm-hmm. Okay. Bear with me for just one moment while I quickly do this. It's a good question. Okay, I'll move on to the next question while I carry on doing the mysterious thing I was doing.
We're all wondering what it is now. You're watching something else?
Yes, playing a video game while you're speaking. No. Okay, I like this question from Pew Pew. Could I add some personal qualities in my covering letter? I feel the personal statement in the CV is quite similar to the covering letter. So how do I make these two sections different and more impressive? Now, there are some similarities, aren't there? But they're not exactly the same. I mean, the personal statement in the CV, the way that you talk about yourself is different, and perhaps the things you focus on is different, whereas a covering letter has a very clear purpose, which is a little different, I would say. What would you both say, and who would like to answer first?
I'll try.
David, okay.
I think, first of all, yes, you can mention personal qualities in the covering letter, to go to the first part of the question, especially in situations where those might be important for the job. I think this is something that you want to highlight in your covering letter. And I think in general, the covering letter is going to be a bit more precise, as in it's directly related to the job that you're applying for. You should have read the advert, you've read the description of the job, hopefully there was one for you to read before you've applied, and you're writing a letter where you explain how you match that job, basically. So you may have personal qualities that are relevant. I don't know if creativity is mentioned as something important in the job, that you'll mention that you are creative, you'll give an example of when you were creative. If specific qualifications were needed, you could mention that you have those. You can refer to the fact that they're listed in your CV. And again, with, you know, other experience or whatever that you have. And basically, you're writing a letter that is selling yourself and saying, please interview me. I deserve the interview, at least, if not the actual job. I think the personal statement of CV is probably more general in that respect, that it's more sort of, you know, often includes, you know, the personal qualities, but it's shorter, almost certainly, and it's more of a general statement of who you are and perhaps who you wish to be in professional life.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good description there. Jenny, anything?
No, I think David's covered everything. Okay. Sorry if that means you can't get on with your mysterious activity. Yes.
You have to pause the game now.
The high score. Okay, fine. Luda has a comment here about Regis's earlier question, which I would read the company's ethos beforehand. I guess that's true. I mean, you know, you can do a lot of research from the company's website. They'll have mission statements and perhaps statements of principles and stuff like that. But when you actually start, I mean, it might not all companies necessarily live up to what they say they will within that. So I guess, you know, it depends on the situation.
But it could be a good starting point, especially if it describes procedures to follow when you think something is wrong.
And it's also really good for the earlier question about questions you can answer at the end of the interview, is that, you know, it might give you some ideas of things that you can prepare to ask and think about going into that. Okay, a statement and a question from Alexander Vladimirov here. As an employer and a candidate, I didn't like long CV. Is one page always enough? That's a very good question. Long CVs, we say on the course, and I think, you know, common recommendation are things to avoid, certainly. But one page, two pages, what would you say, Jenny? Is there a kind of guide for this, you think?
I think it's a personal thing, and it also depends a little bit about the job you're applying for and your experience. So I think One page should be an aim. Your goal should be to whittle everything down to one page. I've been working for over 20 years. I've done a lot of different jobs, but I managed to get it all onto one page, and I think that's a good thing to be able to do. However, sometimes it's not always possible. Imagine if if you've maybe like written lots of publications and you want to, you're applying for a kind of an academic job. In that case, you probably will need to have a longer CV because you'll need to list all of your publications. Or say you're an actor and you've appeared in lots of different television shows, you probably again want to include a list. So although it's not always possible to whittle it down to one page, I think the shorter the better, because we all know how busy recruiters are and they don't have time to wade through big long documents.
David, anything to
I think you should get the most important information on the front page because
Mm-hmm.
that's the one that somebody's definitely going to read. If, like Jenny was saying, there's in this, the types of work you have done or the type of work you're applying for, like academic jobs, you may be required to list, all the publications or research you have done. You could have that in what is effectively an appendix so that people can go and read it if they're interested. But the key things are on the first page so they can quickly see, are you qualified or not for the job, for example, and do you have relevant experience? And if they want more information, it's there if it, if they wish to, read on, as it were.
I think that's very good advice for everything, like front loading everything, putting everything up front. It's this, on your CV, it's the same in your cover letter as well. Very often I see cover letters start with a lot of kind of background information first. Don't do that. Start with the really important stuff about, your recent work, your achievements, and then go back and tell them the extra stuff. And exactly. I think it's always important to think about that. So that's very good advice. Right. We're running out of time. So just very quickly, I'm going to put a quick question up here from another one, a follow-up from Alexander. Do you recommend adding a photo? This is something that comes up very often on the course, Jenny. What's the story here?
It is. I think it does depend a little bit from country to country. So, check out in what the situation is in your own country and what the opinion is about adding a photo to your CV. Certainly in the UK, it's not advisable to add a photo to your CV. This is because it's believed that adding a photo could result in discrimination. So people deciding not to give you a job or give you a job because of the way you look or your age or what have you. So in the UK, no, but check out your own country's situation.
Absolutely. Okay, very last question, then we're going to finish because I think we can do this one very quickly. Shahidullah Katak is saying, in one interview online, the interviewer was interviewing me having the camera off, but I kept my camera on. Was that right? I would say absolutely that was right. I would say it's a bit rude of the interviewer not to put theirs on. I don't know. David, what do you think?
I think if there was a reason for someone to have the camera off, they should explain it. Let's put it like that. I was in an interview recently where one of the myself and two other people were interviewing someone, and one of the interviewers had to have
Was
the, sorry? No.
it
Not unless she's using
Shahidullah?
a different name here, a pseudonym. But one of the people on our panel had to have their camera off because they had a very poor internet connection, and that way we could hear them and they could hear the interviewer. But then we explained this so that it was clear what was happening and the rest of us had our cameras on. I would say that you do want to present yourself. It's part of how, so you would, I would have my camera on even if nobody else did personally.
I would agree. Yeah, I mean, as you say, there could be a very good reason, but they should say what that reason is at the beginning because, I mean, it's quite difficult just talking into space, not being able to see the person you're talking to sometimes in something like an interview. So, okay, so yes, the answer to Shahidullah is yes, you did the right thing. Absolutely, we
And
think.
actually, it's something where I guess if you're worried you're doing the wrong thing, just ask before it starts and say, I've noticed none of you have your camera on. Should I turn my camera off? Would you prefer? And then it's just like a telephone call, isn't it? So.
Okay, thank you both for lots of fantastic and really useful advice and information there again today. I hope everyone watching it has enjoyed it, and it was nice getting to hear some things about you from your experiences, from your job interviews, and your hopes for the future. So that was great. But it's time for us to finish now. So I'm just going to ask Jenny for any final words for the people watching.
Well, first of all, thanks so much for your questions and participation. And if you've enjoyed today and found it useful, then maybe you'll come and join us on the course, which is full of lots more of the same.
Mm-hmm. David, last message, anything?
The same. If you aren't a member of the course, come and join if you found this useful for you, because as Jenny said, there's a lot more detail if you go onto the course.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and we'll be back next week with more live events and lots more kind of sessions like this. So keep watching our Facebook page, our YouTube channel, and our groups to see what's coming up. And we hope to see you again. Okay. Have a nice weekend, everyone. Mm-hmm. And we'll see you again soon. Bye for now.